नमो ओम विष्णुपदाय कृष्ण पृष्ठाय भूतले श्रीमते भक्ति वेदांत स्वामी निति नामिने नमस्ते सरस्वती देवे गौरवाणी प्रचारिणे निर्विशेष शून्यवादी पाश्चात्यांगसुतारिणे श्रील प्रभुपाद की हरे कृष्ण। सो we have quite extensively discussed about naam abhash, and we know the goal is shuddha naam. Shuddha naam means pure chanting of the holy name. The pure chanting will take place when we become completely purified. When we become pure, we'll be able to chant the pure name. And the way to become pure is also by chanting the holy name. And when we chant the pure name, Shuddha Naam, then we'll get Prem, Krishna Prem. And Krishna Prem is the goal of life. Prema Pumartha Mahan. To achieve this Krishna Prem is the ultimate goal, Pumartha, the ultimate goal. So we can see that the course of evolution. Darwin came up with the theory of organic evolution. But actual organic evolution is the spiritual evolution. The organic actually means living. So the pure, the real evolution is spiritual evolution. From little conscious, from almost unconscious state to Krishna conscious state. There are four types of living entities. Four types of, not living entities, four kinds of reproduction. One is Svedaja, sweat. The lowest species of living entities, what are the lowest species of living entities? The microbes. The microbes, how do they reproduce? How do they get their body? The microbes? From one body, it splits into another body. That's how the reproduction takes place. And just like the sweat comes from the body, the reproduction takes place from the body to body. Do you remember amoeba? Right. So that is the lowest form of living entity. Then udbhija, from seeds, the trees and plants. They come from seeds. Then andajas. Andajas from eggs. Like the reptiles and birds come from eggs. And then jarayujas, from embryo. The animals and human beings fall in that category. So you see, the actual evolution is the evolution of consciousness, not the evolution of body, as they tried to establish. That is the monkey's theory of evolution. When the monkeys try to derive something, they come up with a conclusion like that. The monkeys are the forefathers of mankind. Prabhupada's point is, monkeys were there, monkeys are still there. Did you see any monkey become a human being? Sometimes jokingly Prabhupada said, no monkey became a human being, but many human beings gave birth to monkeys. So that is the real evolution. So what is the ultimate form? Among the jarayujas, among the living entities that are born from embryo, which is the most advanced in consciousness? Human beings. Therefore, human life is considered to be extremely rare and extremely valuable. When one gets the human form of life, it's an inconceivable opportunity. It's a matter of inconceivable good fortune. Human form of life. And then, so now let us see what the Vedas are actually deriving, what the Vedas are saying. Vedas are saying that the human form of life, initially, human beings are in ignorance. Janmana jayate shudra. By birth, everyone is in ignorance, shudra. But the human beings have the opportunity to develop his consciousness. The animals, what is their development of consciousness? Say an animal, a puppy is born, and when it's a little puppy and when it's a little big dog, what is the difference of its consciousness? Practically no difference. But a human child and a grown-up human being, what a big difference. Like when he cultivates his intellectual ability, expands his intellectual ability, his consciousness develops. Does any dog learn ABCD? But human being, they start from ABCD. And from ABCD he learns to write a BAT bat, CAT cat. Then it grows further and further. Then he begins to read. Jack and Jill went up the hill. And then he learns even more. Gradually, with his development of his body, his consciousness develops. But the real catch is that he has the ability to take his consciousness to another dimension. That is from material dimension to spiritual dimension. Now how does that take place? How does that transformation from material to spiritual dimension take place? By coming in contact with the bona fide spiritual master. Then only the transformation takes place. From material, he transcends the material nature and enters into the spiritual reality. And what happens when one comes in contact with the bona fide spiritual master? He receives the mantra. That is the purpose of, that is the main objective of coming in contact with the bona fide spiritual master. He receives mantra. Now where does the mantra come from? Where does the mantra come from? Mantra comes from the spiritual world. It is, as we discussed yesterday, why the parampara is so important. Because it is through the parampara that the mantra flows. The sound that actually comes from the spiritual domain remains available to this material nature, generation after generation through this process of chain of disciplic succession. And when one receives mantra, and when one meditates upon the mantra, and he gets the guidance from his spiritual master, he becomes aware of sambandha, abhidheya, and prayajan, then he reaches the ultimate point of prayajan. What is the prayajan? What is the ultimate need? The ultimate need is contentment of the heart. The heart becomes completely content. In the material nature, what is the condition of the heart? The heart is always disturbed, heart is always dissatisfied, heart is always agitated. In the material nature, we are running after so many things, just trying to possess things and exploit things for our sense gratification, never really satisfies our heart. It just keeps on alluring us from point to point, like running after a mirage. But when we come across a bona fide spiritual master, then the heart becomes completely satisfied. Jajatma suprasidati. Atma, the soul, becomes suprasidati, prasidati. You are aware of the word prasanna. Prasanna means content. Evang prasanna manaso bhagavad bhakti yogata bhagavat tatta vijnanam mukta sangasya jayate bhiddate hridaya granthi chiddante sarva sanshaya kshiyante chasya karmani drishta eva atmanishyate. So this is the process. Heart becomes completely satisfied. That is the goal of life. Now satisfaction is the preliminary stage of that goal. What is the ultimate stage? The satisfaction is not the ultimate stage. Joy is the ultimate stage. First, the heart becomes content. Then the heart becomes ecstatic. That ecstasy, anandam, anandam buddhivardhanam. So this way we can see what the holy name is giving us. Holy name is awarding us with the ultimate perfection of our existence, taking us to the ultimate point of achievement. Prema pumartha mahan. Prema, this prem, Krishna prem, is the ultimate goal of life. Or it awards the ultimate goal of life, that is ananda. People are struggling so hard in this material nature to be happy. But do they really want to be happy? No. Happiness is a temporary state. In a suffering condition, when there is some relief, that is called happiness. We in this material nature, we are suffering. And when there is some temporary relief, we call it happiness. But actually, what we want is ananda. Ananda is not a thing of this world. Ananda's reflection is in happiness. Okay, like let us consider this, what happiness is. You are in a dark room and you light a lamp. So it removes the darkness, but can it be a permanent removal of darkness? Only as long as the lamp will be burning, the darkness will be removed. But the moment it is extinguished, again the darkness will prevail. Now you consider, the darkness is synonymous to suffering. And temporary removal of this suffering condition is compared to the lighting of a lamp. So for the time being, the suffering condition is removed and we consider that to be happiness. Cessation of suffering. Now that is one condition. Now you consider the sun comes up in the sky. Will there be any darkness? When the sun comes up, then is there any possibility of darkness being there? No. So Krishna consciousness is something like rising of the sun. So now we are talking about, now let us consider this, the analogy. Darkness is synonymous to suffering. Light is synonymous to joy or happiness. Like opposite to darkness. So that is temporarily relieved. Temporary relief of the suffering condition. But when the sun comes up, is there any need for a lamp? Do you need a lamp to... Similarly, when Krishna consciousness develops, suffering condition is permanently removed. That's why that is considered to be the goal of life. Who wants to suffer? Nobody wants to suffer. So, the permanent cessation of suffering condition is the goal of life. Atyantik dukkha nibritti. Dukkha means suffering, nibritti means cessation. And atyantik means forever. Total. Total removal of suffering condition. So that is what Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is giving. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's teaching has been presented in this way. Aradhya Bhagavan Brajeshwatanai. The supreme worshipable personality of Godhead is the son of Nanda Maharaj, Krishna. Staddhama Vrindavanam. His abode is Vrindavan. Ramma Kachidupashana Brajabadhu Bargena Jakolpita. The way the cowherd damsels, the Brajabadhus, worshipped him, that's the highest form of worship. Srimad Bhagavatam Pramanam Amalam. The proof of that statement or that teaching or that understanding is the spotless Puran Srimad Bhagavatam. Prema Pumartha Mahan. The ultimate goal of life is to receive Krishna Prema. So there, that is a understanding. Namo Mahavadannaya Krishna Prema Pradayati. He came to distribute Krishna Prema. Who is come? Who is that? Krishnaya, Krishna Chaitanya Namna. Krishna himself came to give Krishna Prema in the form of Krishna Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. So now you see what is the holy name is. What is the purpose of holy name? Why Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu gave the holy name? So that we can become free from our suffering condition and experience that endless joy. Anandam buddhi vardhanam. And for that we have to simply chant the holy name. Now as we are discussing, how should we chant the holy name? In order to chant the holy name, we have to become free from our material conditioning. That is what we have to do. And the first consideration, therefore, is to free ourselves from offenses. because the offenses will not enable the name to become manifest himself as Krishna. So 10 offenses, I'm sure all of you are aware of those 10 offenses. How many of you remember those 10 offenses? Please raise your hand. What happened? Your hand didn't go up? Should I ask you? What is the 5th offense? Okay, I thought as well. I'm not asking. Okay, what is the 4th offense? Getting almost there. Anyway, memorize these 10 offenses. Okay, do you want to derive the benefit of chanting? A simple question. How many of you want to derive the benefit of chanting the holy name? Now, in order to derive the benefit of chanting the holy name, what do you have to do? Do you have to continue with the offenses? Committing offenses? So isn't that the first thing that you should try to get rid of? Now in order to get rid of it, don't you have to identify what the offenses are? Therefore, isn't it important to remember these 10 offenses? Now seriously, raise your hand. How many of you remember all 10 offenses? I'm going to ask the question. I'll put you on the spot. That's honest. That's much better. Okay, tomorrow how many of you are going to, by tomorrow how many of you are going to memorize all 10 offenses? Okay, so tomorrow if I ask you, how many hands will go up and how many hands won't go up? Let's see how many hands are going to go up tomorrow. Your hands don't go up. Anandin? What? Yeah, be serious about spiritual life. Like, if you're not serious, then how will you make advancement? If you're not serious, how will you reach the goal? Become serious. That's why these seminars are to remind you what is the power, why you have come to ISKCON, why you have accepted this process. Anyway, so please be serious, and the first consideration is remembering all 10 offenses. I won't ask you to raise hands. Tomorrow I'm going to ask you. It should be remembered so well that you can even remember it from back to forth. So first offense is the most dangerous offense. That is to, very good. The blaspheme, the devotees of the Lord. Now the consideration is, who is a devotee? Who is a devotee? One consideration of a devotee is one who chants the holy name. He is a devotee. Although there are three considerations. One who chants the holy name is a devotee. One who chants the holy name all the time, he is a better devotee. And by seeing him when we feel like chanting ourselves, he is the best devotee. So there are three kinds of devotees. Vaishnava, Kanishtha Adhikari Vaishnava, then Madhyam Adhikari Vaishnava and Uttam Adhikari Vaishnava. So anyway, that means whoever is chanting the holy name, we should recognize him as a devotee and we should point not to hurt him or not to blaspheme him, not to speak bad about him. Blaspheme, the word blaspheme means to speak bad about. Now what constitutes speaking bad? That is to judge a Vaishnava, identify a Vaishnava from his birth, from his caste. Oh, he's a low class Vaishnava. I'm a high class Vaishnava. That is an offense. Vaishnava is a Vaishnava. Vaishnava is transcendental to the material nature. Therefore, one should not judge a Vaishnava from material designation. Generally, in the human society, especially in the past in India, there was this unpleasant discrimination of caste. The higher caste looked down upon the lower caste. And even among the higher caste, there was gradations. Brahmanas, high-class Brahmana, middle-class Brahmana, low-class Brahmana. There was this consideration. One from the higher caste used to look down upon the lower caste. Now when one Vaishnava becomes a Vaishnava, is he still in the bodily platform? Therefore should he recognize him? Should he try to identify him from his bodily designation? No. We have to understand that the Vaishnava is situated in a spiritual identity. Therefore, his bodily designation shouldn't be taken into consideration. So, to consider a Vaishnava, or judge a Vaishnava according to his caste, is a mistake, is an offense. This can be extended also in religion. Oh, he is a Muslim Vaishnava, he is a Christian Vaishnava, he is a Jewish Vaishnava. No. The second consideration is when one becomes a Vaishnava, then he becomes purified. But all his sins may not have been totally eradicated. Some impression may be there. Like once Prabhupada gave the story how our nature is difficult to get rid of. Our nature in the sense, our habits, is difficult to get rid of. Like for example, once a party went to pilgrimage. And there was a person who used to be a thief before. But he became a Vaishnava. So after he became a Vaishnava, he gave up his stealing business. But his propensity remained. So one morning, they found that their shoes are missing. Instead of their shoes, some other shoes were there. So they were very surprised, what happened? Like I left my shoes in front of my door, but now my shoes are gone, somebody else's shoes are here, what happened? So when they're wandering in this way, the thief Vaishnava. Sorry, I shouldn't say thief Vaishnava. That particular Vaishnava, he admitted that, look, I used to be a thief. And at night, this tendency comes back to me. Although I know that I shouldn't steal, but still the tendency is there. So what I did is, I took the shoes and I did that. I took your shoes and put it there, his shoes there. So in this way, sometimes our sinful tendencies remain with us. They may not be completely eradicated, but to judge a Vaishnava according to his past sinful activities, or judging him even for the impressions of the sins that he is still carrying, the propensities that he is still carrying, to judge him according to that is an offense. And what to speak of speaking harshly to a Vaishnava, offending a Vaishnava directly, or even to beat a Vaishnava. So these are, one should never ever do that. One may not get into this gross treatment of beating a Vaishnava, but the tendency may remain to speak bad about a Vaishnava. One should not do that. Even one should not consider the slight sinful tendencies that may be there in a Vaishnava. We should not judge him accordingly. So that is the first offense. The second offense, who remembers? Okay, Ajay.
Consider the names of the demigods independent or different from the name of God.
Yes, the demigods means? You see, demigods, this is an important thing to remember for the Hindus. Often, the Hindus think that all the gods are same. Like for example, you go to Maharashtra, they are worshippers of Ganapati. You go to South India, who do they worship in South India? Murugan? Kartikeya, Murugan. You go to Bengal, they worship Kali and Durga. And you go to North India, they worship no one. No, actually that's not true. Like, in North India, they're worshippers of, yeah, that's true. Part of North India, they worship Hanuman, and that's still better. And a good part of North India also worship Vaishnadevi. Vaishnadevi also Durga Devi. Now these are the demigods. What's the Sanskrit expression for demigod? Dev-devi. Devta. They are all devtas. Who are the devtas? Devtas are different controllers of the affairs of the material, of the universe. In a universe, you have different departments, like just like in a state, you have different, or in a city, you get different departments. Water supply department, electric supply department, a public works department, and so forth, education department, finance department. And similarly, in the universal affair also, there are different departments, and they are different in charge of those departments. Like wind department, who is in charge? Pavan Dev. Water department? Varun Dev. Fire department? Agni Dev. So these are all Dev, Devtas. In an universe, these different, like as we say, Ganesh. Who is Ganesh? He gives success. Who is Kartik? He is the general of the demigods. So these are all demigods, devtas. They are taking care of different affairs of the universe. But there are innumerable universes. And who is the creator of all those universes? Bhagavan. So this is how there is a difference between Devta and Bhagavan. So now, should we consider the Devtas are equal to Bhagavan? So that is an offense. Bhagavan is the supreme personality of Godhead. But Devdevis are the controllers. From our point of view, they may be very, very powerful individuals, but they are not equal to the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Alright? So will you consider Durga to be equal to Krishna? Ganesh to be equal to Krishna? Kali to be equal to Krishna? No. There is no Bengali, that's why. And so Krishna's to Bhagavan Swayam. That understanding should be clear. If we don't, then we will commit the second offense. Third offense? Yes, ma'am. To disobey the orders of the spiritual master. Be careful. The spiritual master asked you to come 5 minutes before the class starts. Okay, so you got the point. Huh? So, the point is, the spiritual master instructs to help us in our spiritual progress. His instructions are meant to help us in our spiritual progress. Now, to disobey his orders is going to cause impediment. That is an offense. Then, the fourth offense, I think you all said it right. Very good. To blaspheme the Vedic literatures and literatures in pursuance to the Vedic version. So Vedas and subsidiary supporting literatures are actually meant to give us the information about the spiritual reality and enable us to make spiritual advancement. Now, if we blaspheme those literatures, will that be proper? Fifth offense. Okay, raise your hand. Okay, to consider the chanting of the glories of the holy name to be imagination. The glories of the holy name, like what is the glory of the holy name? The glory of the holy name is? The holy name is Krishna himself. Or as we have been discussing, that just in Namabhar stage, all the sins are eradicated. One achieves liberation in Namabhar stage. And just as Gopal Chakravarti offended Haridas Thakur. He got into an argument with Haridas. He didn't accept that. So that is to consider the glory of the holy name to be imagination. And the sixth offense? Yeah. The sixth offense is to the sixth offense is to give some mundane interpretation. So is the holy name spiritual or something of this material nature?
Spiritual.
It's spiritual. So it's spiritual. To give it some mundane connotation is an offense. To think that it is something of this world, like Krishna, the name Krishna is a combination of four syllables. Ka, Ri, Sha, Na. So Krishna. So if we say Ka means this, Sha means this, Ra means this, and Na means this, therefore Krishna actually means this. That is one example of giving a mundane interpretation, material interpretation. Krishna's name means Krishna himself, best. What's the problem? But some people, they tend to do that. Or give some mundane mundane purpose be to be the purpose of chanting holy name. You chant holy name, you'll get a lot of punya. Punya is material. You chant the holy name, you'll be liberated. You chant holy name, you'll be very happy. You chant the holy name, your son will get a good job. You chant the holy name, your daughter will get a good husband. So these are all the mundane, giving some mundane objective to the holy name. So that should not be done. That's the sixth offense. Seventh offense, to commit sinful activities on the strength of chanting the holy name. It says that the amount of sin that one name of Krishna can remove, can no one has the ability to commit that much sin. Ak Krishna name jato pap hare, kono papir shaddha nai tato pap kare. See the potency of the holy name? Sins are automatically eradicated just by chanting. Now if somebody thinks, oh, nice opportunity, I'll continue to commit sins and I'll continue to chant the holy name. So I'll be free from sinful reaction. Prabhupada used to tell us that the classic example of that is that the Christians going to the church on Sunday and getting free from their sinful reaction, dumping their sin to Jesus. So, one should not think like that one, because he is chanting the holy name, he has the liberty to commit sin. In that respect, Prabhupada gave the example that you commit a crime, you are arrested, you are taken to the court, and you appeal to the judge, please forgive me. The judge may forgive you, not punish you. Then again you commit the same sin, same crime, arrested. Second time also the judge may forgive you. But the third time when you go and tell the judge, please forgive me, what the judge will say? No mercy. Right? So similarly, we have committed our sinful activities in the past, knowingly or unknowingly, but now that we have taken shelter of the holy name, all our sins have been removed, but now no more sin, no more sinful activities. That's why following the four regulative principles is so important. It's protecting us from committing sinful activities. Because if we don't indulge in these four activities, then there is no possibility of sin even touching us. So, when we take shelter of Krishna's lotus feet, although Krishna gave the assurance, aham tvam sarva papibhyo moksha ishami, that Krishna will do when we surrender to Krishna, Krishna will free us from all our sinful activities, but then, from then onwards, no more sinful activities. But as due to our bad habits, sometimes we may do something like that as a thief who became a Vaishnav did to the other member of the pilgrimage party. But we should try not to even do that. Was the eighth offense? Okay, I think your voice is the loudest one. Just you say it. Very good. So Karmakanda section of the Vedas give us the prescription of enjoying in this material nature, which is called fruitive activity. Karmakanda, the fruitive. Like you do this, you'll get that result. You go to such and such place and offer such and such puja and you will get this benefit. So as I was saying, son getting a good job, daughter getting a nice husband, these are all, it's possible. There are some activities that can, the Karmakanda section of the Vedas are giving that kind of prescription. But the purpose of chanting the holy name should not be that. We should not chant the holy name to derive some material benefit. The purpose of chanting of the holy name should be simply to receive Krishna prema. The ninth offense, okay, Ratna Radhika, you say it. A person who is averse to Krishna, who doesn't really have the faith that Krishna is the Supreme Personality of Godhead, and you start to sing the glory to Him, You know, the holy name can do this. Holy name is Krishna himself. Like those who are offender to Krishna, they will become even more offensive. Therefore, it's better to avoid. Don't give it to somebody who is not going to understand the value of this holy name. It's a wastage of time, energy and effort. There is an English expression, casting pearls in front of a swine. Will the swine or a pig ever understand what is the value of a pearl? He'll sniff it and say, oh, it doesn't smell like stool. No use. Right? So, we should not unnecessarily try to distribute or sing the glory of the holy name to a faithless person. And the tenth offense? Okay. Gita, you can sing. Very good. So we get quite a few points here. Tell us what's the first point. Right. Not to have complete faith. The complete faith means the holy name is Krishna. Any doubt? Fully full faith in that understanding? The holy name is Krishna. So not to have the faith and to maintain material attachments even after accepting this process. And another point she mentioned, to be inattentive while chanting. So, and then what is the last point? Yes, very good point. Those who want to make spiritual advancement, what they should do? They should guard against these offenses. Will it be difficult? When the heart becomes purified, it won't be difficult. The tendency to enjoy this material nature brings another attitude to establish ourselves as the greatest. That is actually the outcome of this desire to enjoy this material nature. So when you give up that tendency, then only we can become humble. And the real secret is in this humble attitude. Like we consider ourselves to be insignificant, lower than the lowest, and do not aspire for anything, any recognition in this material nature. In simple words, we can say that we should always remember that we have nothing to gain in this material world. Our goal is the spiritual world. Let all our endeavor be to achieve that destination. And when we do that, then yes, we'll be rewarded. Krishna is watching. So when we chant, we should not consider how people are recognizing me or not. What really matters is whether Krishna is recognizing us. Let's always be vigilant, always be cautious and aware that Krishna is watching us. And when Krishna sees that we are sincerely practicing the process, then Krishna will be pleased and Krishna will reward us. That is how the real reward will come from Krishna. That's what we should aspire for. Thank you all very much. All glories to Srila Prabhupada. I'll open up for the question answer.